Okay, so we're recording now, but I just wanted to show this to everybody who didn't get to see it on their way in. But when people register, when you've registered for the Midday Connect, one of the questions in the registration form is, what are your top three challenges in your business? I just took all of those answers and put them into a word cloud really quick this morning, and I just thought it would be interesting to share with everybody. Just FYI, just because I thought it was interesting. So someone asked what the top one was. The top word or most used word was finding. I think it had 40 mentions across the 210 registrants, but I'm imagining that's because people are trying to find all of this other stuff. But the reason that I ask those questions is so that I can make sure that we get the speakers who are going to be interesting and address the challenges for all the midday connectors. So just thought this was interesting. Any other insights that anybody else sees, or can you commiserate with everybody else? I imagine so.
Are they grouped? Are they grouped by size, meaning sizes?
Frequency. Yeah, size is
Frequency.
frequency on this one.
Okay.
I'm not a professional word art creator. This was just the first free word cloud creator that I could find. So just thought it was interesting. So I think one of the or several of those items in terms of challenges was around product. And so that's a little bit of what we'll address today with Ryan Badger. So Ryan, I've known for quite a few years, and he has been building apps recently using a no-code platform called Bubble. And so I asked him to come and talk to us about his experience doing that. What he's found, where the best applications for a no-code platform versus a customized app development. So I'm going to let Ryan take the stage. Do you have anything you want to share on the screen, Ryan? I haven't looked, but I imagine he was still here. Yep, there we go.
Hey, sorry about that.
No
Yeah,
worries.
I can share my screen here.
Okay, let me allow for that. And then also, if you don't mind, Ryan, just giving a little bit more and a better background than I was able to do on yourself, so people kind of know where you're coming from and know who you are.
Yeah, sure. So let's see. I earned an MBA in 2014. Before that, I worked for a web hosting company, Bluehost, and did a lot of work with WordPress websites, Magento. Basically, a lot of PHP websites, and figured out kind of a lot of the ins and outs of hosting and websites and apps and what some of the technologies were that were out there. I went on to work for companies that developed apps in PHP, Ruby on Rails, Adobe Experience Manager, and managed projects for these companies, kind of realizing that a lot of the software that they were using was pretty heavy and overkill. And I've always struggled to learn how to code. I mean, I've been through a lot of online tutorials and it just never really clicked with me. So I've been looking at these solutions like Zapier and Integromat and some of the no code connectors. And it finally, about 4 years ago, started to click, and these solutions started to blow to the top as actually viable ones that didn't have a lot of downsides. So the one that I came across that I really have enjoyed and made a pretty strong turn towards is this bubble.io. What I really like about it is that it doesn't really limit you at all on a lot of the way the traditional app builders would. You get a great abstraction of your visual interface, your workflows or programming portion of it, the connectivity to APIs to import data or interact with outside data, and then plugins in order to extend functionality, add different elements, and everything from functionality to visual elements. And then also the database. They've captured this all into one discrete platform, and I think that's pretty awesome. I haven't really seen that done before. So I feel like we're just living in the future, and this is the way that web app development should be done. The other cool thing that you can do with this is you're developing a progressive web app that works on multiple screen sizes, but you can also wrap it in it's just called a wrapper, and launch it onto the Android and iOS app store. So with this one program, you can build a really great MVP type app, get it launched on the app stores, and test out your idea. I've been working with a lot of students over the last year, and a lot of people just building apps, and have learned a lot about what the challenges and struggles are that they have. I started teaching this Bubble Bootcamp for the Bubble.io company. And I think that's a great way to get started. It's a great way to, over the course of 8 weeks, get your feet wet, understand all the ins and outs, and build a kind of a simple MVP type app. So that's the guidance that I have nowadays. I think the course is a great way to start, but people have a lot of different types of apps that they want to build. There's definitely a sweet spot for Bubble. A lot of the apps that I'm building nowadays and helping with have very specific niche purposes. One of them that I'm working on is retrieves insurance information for a dental office. So rather than having the receptionist call in to your insurance company when you call them, they wait on hold for 45 minutes. They get some selective information back. This app allows them to punch in your information. It uses an API to retrieve insurance information, and they can tell you instantaneously, hey, here's where your coverage is, here's how much you've spent. They can email you out a copy of basically your coverage basics. So it's a very, very niche type thing, but it could have, potentially hundreds of thousands of users, probably not millions of users. And really fits within kind of the sweet spot of what Bubble does. So I think there are a lot of fundamental decisions when you're creating an app. I usually try and go towards the hard requirements. What are the two or three tough features that are going to make the app actually unique? All of the basic things like users being able to log in, create accounts, create profiles, all of those things are really well established. So I don't worry too much about those things. But yeah, most of the apps that we come across are one or two features away from a different popular app, and a lot of the functionality can be inferred. So the goal with Bubble is kind of to build an MVP within 8 weeks. I think that's a pretty realistic goal once you know the ins and outs. So there are lots of other technologies out there. This is the one that I like. This is what I do. And could change in the future, but I think for right now, they're really providing an amazing platform to create apps on, apps and other website development. So I really like this no-code trend. I think that it just makes a lot of sense. I think it's the next progression. So if you guys have any questions about no-code apps or Bubble, I'm here to help.
Ryan, one of the questions I had was how to choose between whether you should go no-code or custom build. And then it looks like Rob has a question as well.
Yeah, sure. So it's usually based on budget. It definitely depends on what you're building. But if you're trying to launch a mobile app, and you're going to be maintaining both of your code bases, that's going to be expensive. So I think the biggest decision factor is just what's your budget. And if you have a user base to support the full app development, that's probably a better route. But if you're just trying to test an idea and have $5, $10, $15,000 to throw at an idea to validate it, that's I think Bubble's a great way to go.
Cool. Looks, Rob, do you want to just unmute yourself? And then Ryan, if you can check out the chat as well, there are some questions in there and comments that I think we could run through.
Yeah, sure.
Thanks, Taylor. What's up, Ryan? Good to see you, brother.
Yeah, good to see you too.
So just curious what your thoughts are for the best apps to build in this kind of environment and what things you would avoid building, like not a good use case or things to like you've seen maybe more complicated or like, is there kind of a sweet spot? Oh, if you're doing these things, you should totally do it in Bubble. And if you're doing this stuff, definitely don't look this way for no code.
Yeah. Two apps come to mind. So the, the hellish story first is an app that came with all these different requirements. It's got to function this way. It absolutely has to be this way or it won't work. That's not a great approach, I would say, because you're going to have a lot of flexibility where the Bubble way of doing it's a little bit different than the way that you dictated or you draw it on your wireframe. Will that still work? So if you have a bunch of rigid requirements, that's probably not a great way to start. But if you, I think the best apps are ones that are utilizing API data that hasn't really been tapped into before. And that can come in a bunch of different flavors. Even an API like Google Places has a lot of room to grow. You get this great list of places that are being updated, and you can, I mean, potentially in an app, you could add to that data and enrich that data for your users. So if you wanted, you can kind of pin it on Google Places, for instance, but then with that as the basis of your app and then maintaining all that data, you've got something that's very useful for your niche audience potentially. So find an API that's got some great data that's not being utilized and make an interface for it. That's a great app.
What's your favorite app so far that you've seen, like of all the things you've done or seen in boot camps or whatever that you've taught, like, are you like, oh man, this was like the coolest app I've seen yet somebody build or that you've helped put together?
Oh man, this dental one I think is pretty slick. It's got all the good ingredients for an actual viable product, which I think is the best kind of app. It doesn't have the nicest interface. It doesn't have the slickest functionality, but as far as usefulness, I mean, it's saving offices tons and tons and tons of time. So I think those are the coolest apps, I think.
Very cool. Maybe Ryan, if you could either throw a link in the chat for the app, if it's on the App Store, maybe people could go and look at it. There are a couple questions in the chat asking if you could share your screen and show how to just initially get started or show some of the functionality of Bubble and how you're using it. And then it looks like Maxwell and Tyler have also raised their hands. Dale has some questions about costs.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so Tim, I saw your comment there. I love Bubble too. It's pretty awesome. Tyler, so Adalo is an alternative to Bubble. There are a couple of other ones that I've used in the past. I mean, I am very agnostic when it comes to the technology. I don't really have any allegiance to Bubble other than it works. So if there's another one out there, I'd definitely be willing to check it out. A lot of them really limit you in some way. And I think Bubble's kind of open those doors. If it's APIs or workflows or screen layouts or something like that, there's usually some kind of limitation. Bubble has its own limitations, but I think they've kind of done a good job of kind of massaging those. And then what did you want to see through a screen share? I can just a getting started.
Oh, sorry. That was my comment. If it sounded like you were sharing your screen, but if you weren't, don't worry about it.
Oh, sorry. I thought I was sharing. Yeah.
And maybe I'm the only one that didn't see it. I don't know. I could be the only one.
So I shared the link to this app. It's pretty fresh. So feel free to check it out. yeah, here's the screen I was sharing before, just the bubble.io website. We can jump into an app. I can show some of the basics. I don't know if that would be a good use of time. I'm not sure how much time I have.
Yeah, we will typically go for another 20 or so minutes. And it looks like, so yeah, whatever you think would be most helpful in terms of getting people started in Bubble and what challenges they may have as they kick things off. But it also looks like Maxwell, Tyler, and Spencer have their hands up. So Maxwell, do you want to just unmute yourself and ask?
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here. I was just curious if you could draw maybe a finer line between if you're seeing apps that are trending more B2C or B2B, or like not even customer facing and internal use cases only. In the example of the dental, right, that's back office workflow that you're automating and providing click access to. So I was just curious if you had a sense of what comes out more from Bubble, something that's more utility or something that's actually customer facing?
A lot of utilities. I mean, there are definitely customer facing apps, but I think the real popular ones are utilities for, I would say, small to medium sized companies. I would go so far as to say that's where sort of the most interesting apps are coming from. I was just helping somebody with the reverse logistics app. They buy pallets and have to inventory all the items, value them, describe them, push them out to other channels. So it's potentially an app that they could launch as a platform, white label it, something like that. But even just as a unique app for their company, it doesn't cost them a ton to develop it and they get exactly what they want. So it's sort of bridging that dream of custom software for a small to medium sized company. I used to hear this term around CRMs, like I forget what it is. Something about growing your own CRM and what the pitfalls of that are. I think we're almost about to turn that page where instead of spending an enormous amount on some type of a CRM subscription, you might be able to build it on your own through Bubble and get the functionality that you need at a lesser cost, which is pretty exciting. Obviously, there are some maintenance things that go into that, but I've seen several companies do that where they have one of my students had like a pressure washing business, and he knew who his customer was, he knew how he had to process jobs, and just built a Bubble app for it. And so it works great, it powers his entire business. So I think that's a very, very popular trend.
Ryan, you mentioned cost. Dale had a question about cost in the chat. He said, you mentioned $5,000 to $15,000 to build an app on Bubble. What would those costs be? Like, what is the breakdown of that cost? Is it just development, or where would people be spending money?
Primarily just development. The subscription fees are pretty minimal. I think it's $29 a month for like a personal plan, and then $120 a month for like the pro plan. Most everybody can get by on the personal plan initially. But yeah, there's just a lot of development cost and going through every single feature. You can start with a template, which may speed things up in some cases, but for the most part, you don't get anything for free. So if you want to be able to have your users reset their password, that's going to take a little time to develop. And obviously the complex features much more time, but that's just kind of a range. I haven't really come across any extremely expensive apps where people wanted to spend $100,000 on a Bubble app. The limitation that you have is that it's owned by Bubble. It's not open source. It's hosted on their servers. So I think a lot of the vetting that goes on in larger companies probably rules them out, because there's just too high of a risk there. But for an MVP where you're not really tuned into that risk, I think it's an awesome option.
Very cool. Tyler Fox, do you want to unmute yourself? Looks like you had
your... Yeah. You hear me all right?
Yep.
I just had a couple questions. Do you know if it's possible to build a cross-platform like browser extension? And also, sorry, I have two questions. And is it possible to do like a native app within Bubble?
Okay. So cross-browser extension. I came across this. I hadn't really looked into it, but let me see if I can find the link. Would this just be like a Chrome extension?
Yeah, Chrome, Safari, Safari iOS. I mean, something like that that could work on mobile and desktop. I've used Bubble a little bit, but the only thing I didn't like about it is I didn't, you know, quite get into building the APIs and connecting things that I wanted to do. So I'd love to, you know, learn more about that side of it, but I just didn't know if the extension type thing was even possible with it.
Yeah, so here's an article on the Chrome extension. I'll just drop this. I have not vetted this at all. I don't know how well it works, but it looks like it's possible.
No, cool. Sweet.
And then you won't have the ability to build a native app. You're building a progressive web app and then just wrapping it. One of the
Okay.
popular wrappers right now is BBK. There's some additional cost, like, I don't know, $150 or something to get it wrapped. But...
And does that $150 just cover you for like, does it cover you for all app stores? I mean, like if you want to publish it on Android and iOS, or is it just you have to pick one?
This is just going to give you the wrapper. It's going to give you
you could publish it in both, right?
Yeah, it gives you the ability to publish it. You're still going to need your own Android account, your own Apple developer account.
Right. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's a really powerful thing.
You want to unmute yourself? Ask a question? Sorry, Ryan, I interrupted you. You can keep going.
Oh, no, you're fine. I think I wrapped that up there. Dale had a question about how much does... How much no code does no code mean? You can definitely build it with no code at all, just using different elements and
because my question is, no code. If you're talking about finding an API that's exposed publicly and then using Bubble to create an app that will integrate with that API, where I mean, I guess maybe I'm at least on like the nature of those APIs and how prepped those APIs maybe are for no code integrations, because like most public facing APIs, I do is I just list technical documentation with, you know, the code that they offer and the code that you need to integrate with their service. And so that's different from going to a API that like has an integration already available. So I guess my question is, like, we're talking about no code only with those third-party services that already have like a user-facing no code plugin, any exposed API where coding is necessary.
So to be more specific about that, you can integrate with any REST API. So let me share my screen again here. So I've got kind of this demo app that I play around with. And one of the most powerful tools within Bubble is this API connector plugin. It allows you to build out your own custom API connections. So, I mean, just a really simple one here. I'm not exactly sure that these work. It's been a while since I've looked at them. But here's just a random number generator. So I give it a min, I give it a max, I hit this endpoint, and it's going to give me a random number here. So that's maybe the most simple use case for APIs. Just a very simple get, call, and a REST API. But you can do much, much more complicated things than that. So I think I've got Shopify in here. Yeah, just a call to get products, but you could manage an entire Shopify store. So Shopify is this great published API. You could set up every single endpoint and have full access to managing your Shopify store. So we've done that a little bit before with like building product uploader interfaces. When I was working with a bookstore and they they needed the ability on a phone to scan a book, grab all the product information from external API sources, and then push it to their Shopify store. So that's all accomplished through setting up these types of REST calls. So the sky's the limit. There are so many REST APIs out there. I think any of them should be connectable through this type of interface.
So I think my question then, Ryan, is like, if I have an idea and I'm wanting to build it, do I need to, is there like a decision matrix where it's like, don't use no code because, I mean, it's great to build maybe an MVP, but it's not going to be robust enough to, you know, what you're going to want to build something that could potentially grow really large, or is it going to continue to be something you could have and just exist? I mean, yeah. How do you know?
Yeah, it's a really common question. You don't want to invest a ton of time and money into something that you're going to outgrow relatively quickly. I don't think that that's a problem that I've come across, though. I mean, it's definitely a concern, but I haven't really seen that in the wild. For the most part, people make missteps in validating their idea. They'll spend a lot of money or a lot of time developing an app, and then they're testing the wrong thing. So it just becomes a validation exercise. But the apps that are successful, I think, iteratively add the features that they need when they need them and become a very useful tool. I don't think that, like on the dental app, they're not going to have, I mean, if it got deployed at every single dental office in the US, I think it would run just fine on Bubble. Bubbles just run on AWS. So you have all of that architecture magic behind the scenes to offer scalability. So as long as you build your individual steps efficiently, it can scale with a lot of breadth. So you can.
So yeah, and do they? So if let's say there was something that went down with it, you're going to get a phone call from a dentist's office, say, but are you then, or is there support offered through Bubble, or how does that work?
There is. So going down as far as like a coding issue, or going down as something in their infrastructure has failed, they have actual downtime. I think with either case, I mean, you've got to provide support. So there's not a lot that you can do about the Bubble downtime. They have a pretty good record. I would say it could be a little bit better. Most of my clients that have already launched their MVP apps just retain me as a support person in case they do have any issues that come up. So I think you've got to address both sides of that. I've had some students that were really concerned about 100% uptime or as close as possible. I don't know that it's appropriate for that. Like this, in the case of this dental app, excuse me, if it goes down for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, it's not the end of the world. So I think I would look at it, look at your use case and see if that's actually going to be an issue. Cool. Excuse me. I think a lot of people have really high demands for uptime. They want it to be up 100% of the time, but don't realize that they can probably survive on 99% uptime.
Tim Cooley, you said that you built one, you went through a boot camp, and now you've started another one and you need help with it. What challenges are you facing as you've built those, and what help do you need?
I think the biggest thing is, so I'm like Ryan, I started learning to code, I launched games, and this was much easier to get started. Once it gets complicated, I think the forums aren't that great, as far as, you know, if you go to Stack Overflow, you can get anything answered in like pretty quickly. But with Bubble, it takes a long time. And even going through the boot camp, I didn't go through Ryan's, but I went through someone else's, and the response on that kind of stuff can take a while. It just, sometimes you just don't know where to go. You have the idea of what you need to have happen, but you can't figure out how to make it happen, just like in coding.
It's been an interesting journey for me to try and figure that out, because I thought I could just build it all myself. I'm not going to pay somebody to build this. I'm the developer. I'll develop it. But then you run into these roadblocks where something that should take 20 minutes ends up taking 2 weeks and you can't figure it out. So I've tried to position my business that way where I offer like 2 hour time blocks where people can just do a join a Zoom session like this. They drive or I drive, and we try and work through those issues. That's been really helpful for these people. I mean, we'll knock out 3 or 4 features within the 2 hours. So I think that's kind of where things are headed. I like to see students progressing, or you know, call them students, but they're really everything from CEOs of companies to engineers that have a really good understanding of how these things work and how to build it. But I can definitely imagine them getting into a scenario where you just hit one little roadblock and completely slows you down. You don't want that. It's a rapid development platform. If you can't develop it rapidly, what's the point?
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, that's where I'm stuck right now. We'll chat offline, but I think that, I mean, I'm so much further, and you get into it so much faster than coding it in from scratch. So I'm a fan. I can't wait to figure it all out.
Well, that's really good to hear. I'm in the same boat. I mean, I was really gung-ho about Ruby on Rails 6 or 7 years ago. I was going to learn that, and that was going to be what I did. And it's just so hard. It's so difficult getting all the, I mean, becoming really proficient at it, I think, is just a much steeper learning curve than what I've experienced with Bubble.
Ryan, another question in the chat. Where is the data stored, and then who owns that data? And then the second one was, any sense of how Bubble charges if you end up with 500,000 users?
Yeah, so Bubble has, I'll take the last question first. They have plans at that threshold, the $29 a month, the $119 a month, but they'll go all the way up to a dedicated instance. So that's pretty cool. You can have, and they're basically kind of custom designing this instance for you if you have that many users. So in scalability, I really don't have too many concerns there. Who owns the data? I believe it's Bubble, which is a big no-no for a lot of developers, but it's a proprietary platform. They've said that if anything happens to the business, they would release it as a package that could be hosted elsewhere. But yeah, that's definitely a concern for some people. And it may eliminate some types of platforms. I don't know, like on a HIPAA-compliant medical platform, you might have some issues with that type of thing. Sorry, there was one more question in there.
Where is it stored?
Yeah, so it's all on AWS. So if you're uploading files, there's a corresponding S3 bucket. If you're uploading data, I think they're using RDS, something similar.
Okay. Another question from Ben Rollins. How much improvement in the platform have you seen over the years? I know they raised a seed round not long ago.
A lot. I think they're a sleeping giant. I think that, I mean, they raised like $6 million. And I see some of these platforms that are sponsored by Cisco or Amazon are raising hundreds of millions. I think they could go head to head with that type of a platform. And they've really ironed it out, gotten rid of a lot of issues that I saw in the past. I think it's a really, just a really nicely evolved platform. They've been around almost 10 years. And I think within the last year or two, they've really hit their stride.
Very cool. I don't see other questions in the chat. Does anyone else have questions? If so, either raise your hand or throw it in the chat. I know there was some interest or mentions, Ryan, about the boot camp. A couple people said they'd be interested in it. That's one of the things that I saw when you posted that on LinkedIn. Can you share a little bit more information about that boot camp you're running?
Yeah, so I've only done this a few different times. I was really excited to get on with Bubble and start teaching for them. That was a big goal of mine. But basically in 8 weeks, we take you through all of the ins and outs of Bubble. There's a lot there. I mean, typically in an app development, you'd have somebody that's focusing on design, somebody that's maybe focusing on database architecture, user experience. With Bubble, you're wearing all of those hats. So we walk you through the each of those kind of corners of the app, and then I think what's really helped out my students is I'll offer just a 45-minute session per week as a one-on-one, and the same type of thing, either help them get started or help them overcome any issues. So that's been really valuable for the students that have done well in the class.
Very cool. Any other questions before we sign off? This has been awesome, Ryan. I really appreciate it. And then what's the best way for people to get a hold of you, Ryan, if they have additional questions? Can you throw that in the chat too?
Yeah, I'll put that in the chat here.
Okay.
Sorry, my chat's disappearing. There it goes. Yeah, so I'll drop the link to the boot camp. I mean, there are lots of great instructors. I don't know that I'm the best, but if the times align and you can join, that would be awesome. And then on my website, slickrock.dev, you can see a little bit more about how we package the, like a 45-minute session or a 2-hour session, or if you want a full-blown web development, we can quote that out.
Very cool. This is awesome, Ryan. One note that I wanted to make also, Jeff Erickson, do you mind unmuting yourself and letting people know about Startup Stack? And Ryan, if there's any other resources that you would share, happy to share that with the group. I'll send out my notes to everybody on what I took down, but would also love anyone else that has learned something, share it with the group. But Ryan, thanks so much for your time. This is awesome.
Yeah, I appreciate it, guys. Thanks for the opportunity.
Cool. Before we shut down, Jeff, do you want to take a second and just share what Startup Stack is?
Sure. Yeah, Ryan, hey, thank you. This was super cool, very interesting. Appreciate it. Yeah, with Startup Stack, we are launching something today. This has been something that Jonathan Engel and I have been working with Dialpad and some other providers on. And what it is, basically, it's a group of tech, operational tech offerings that are specifically for startup founders. So companies that are bootstrapping, you've got special offers from companies like Dialpad, Venture Validator, Brex, and some others that are operational things that you need as a founder that you can get for free or for deep discounts from these providers as a bootstrapping founder. So the new site is going to be, like I said, is launching today, but it's called mystartupstack.com. And Summit Venture Studio has been a great partner, and we appreciate them. But anything else to add there, Taylor?
No, that's awesome. I just wanted to share it with everybody because I think it's super cool what you put together there. So yeah, I would say just everybody go check it out. I mean, that's kind of what I'm trying to do with the Midday Connect is just provide resources for business owners. So this is, I think, just aligning with that and really helping out early stage businesses and new startups. So I appreciate it. Thanks, Jeff.
Yeah, thank you, Taylor.
Yeah. Well, thanks everybody for jumping on. We'll see you next week and appreciate everybody's comments and questions. And Ryan, thanks so much for educating us.
Have a good one, y'all.
Hey, thanks.
Bye.